This
Today,
conference will now be recorded.
we are going to start with Python collections. Earlier I told in the last class we had a discussion about strings, and we had discussed many things in string actually. That's a good session, and today I would like to introduce you. What is that? Python collections. Okay. So earlier we had discussed about many things like what else we have discussed. We have discussed about loops. We have discussed about control statements, and then we had discussed about all the fundamentals. There are few more fundamentals we need to discuss, like you know. And also we had an introduction to mutability and immutability in the last session. But anyhow, while moving forward, we learn many more new things. From our session. So let's switch to the another topic, which is what we call collections. Might be in another file. No problem. I'll just bring out that. I told you to take two files from the GitHub. One is what is that? Data science, that is one folder name, one file name, and the other one is Python, this one actually. Let me see if I have downloaded here the data science. Just a minute, let me get it in, get it from the GitHub. Okay. One minute, guys. So I told you this is our GitHub account, and you know, you can get these files whenever you want. Okay, there are some other files even. If you are interested, you can access them too, but it's up to you. But right now, I just need only one thing. What is that one thing? This data science thing for us, you know, to learn this collections. Okay. So now let us see this, how collections are there. Once we finish collections, parallelly I will introduce you to analytical Python, like you know, same collections, how we do in Python. And how we apply with analytical Python, like you know, how do we use NumPy or pandas or you know, scifi, or how to plot little values from arrays. All that we discuss soon after finishing this, okay? So that you understand parallelly how to, and also we also solve some of the basic algorithms or you know, basic fundamentals of which one? This machine learning, like you know. Understanding this mean, median, mode, or no, standard deviation, many more. We can apply all that with what is that? With your this thing. Yes, with your Python itself, you can apply all those algorithms. Yes, you can see here now. This one. This is our collections topic. So. What is a collection? Let's have a quick understanding, and why it is very much, you know, very much important and core concept in Python, or crucial, you know? Because even in our day-to-day tasks which we are doing while working with our big data, I keep writing, you know, utilities, at least one or two utilities, at least a day or alternative days. So most of the time I depend on this, which one is I depend on this collections, because you know, when you talk about this kind of analytical analysis like big data, data science, these are very useful for us. Okay, so that's why using this is these collections are very much necessary. Okay, so we'll start from here. Let's get into the introduction to this part. Okay, so anyhow, when we'll come to know a couple of other things also. And we had discussed in the last class too, what is that? String is immutable, isn't it? You know what is immutable? We cannot modify it. Modify in sense what, at what level? At program level or at memory level? We can change at program level, but at memory level, object is not modified. It's not changed. That's what I had discussed in the last session. Okay, and I told you it's not just string. Even other data types in Python are immutable. When you talk about int or float or double R, you know, all these are immutable objects. And you have asked me like why it is immutable, and I had explained clearly like the advantages of being immutable. I hope you remember that. So that is another important thing. And you know, might be implementation part if you have some idea, those who are new to the session. Otherwise, you know, already I told you. So which one from, as a part of our this thing learning practices, we have our own YouTube channel for Learn Well, which is what we call Learn Well Space Tech. So you can go there and you know, you can back up yourself. And I have uploaded all those videos there. Our channel name is this. Take a backup from this channel. Okay. Now, as we had discussed, mutable means something we can change. Immutable means something which we cannot change. Okay. I'll give more analysis on this. Now, and I told you just now, even earlier also, in Python by default objects are created from values, for values from 0 to 256 before the interpreter is started itself. If we initialize any objects from 0 to 256, the address is same for all objects. If we initialize any other value than other than 256, 0 to 256, then a new object is created. The statement is a bit confusing to all of us. Unless and until we see that in the command prompt, we don't have a clear understanding about this. So what you do is just open your command prompt. What is that we should do? You have your command prompt here, and then just clear the screen. OS.system of, you know, this clear command, right? Before that, if anybody is new to the session who are online, I suggest you to open any online editor, Python editor or compiler, or install your Python software immediately. I had downloaded PyCharm also for you. Sorry, not PyCharm, Anaconda. Might be I will also use Anaconda. So now coming to the point, I take earlier, I think this is what when I was doing, I think there is a difference from the latest version, like from 3.6 or 3.7. There is a lot of difference, but anyhow, we'll see. Suppose you take up to 256. This is an integer. That's what we are talking about, integers, not strings here. What they say is A equal to 256, B equal to 0 to 256, right? Or 255, probably 255, altogether 256. Now, you know how to find address of any object before going to talk about collection, introduction. Collection, because in collection even there is a point on this topic. So we need to understand what is this, that statement which I have just introduced to all of you. What is the point there? In Python by default objects are created for values to from 0 to 256. This is the point. So okay, I got it. So you are not able to see that, huh? Succeeding. Is it fine now? Okay, fine. So let's just quickly test this. It's not the resolution. 1 minute. 1 minute, folks. Let me just see how to find address, right? ID is the function which we should apply. These are all, you know, very simple things. If you just concentrate, you understand. If you don't have idea about previous sessions, okay, leave it like that. Don't keep that thought in the mind. You cannot enjoy this session. Okay, you have to bear with me at least for 2 hours from now, at least 2 to 2.5 hours. It's not that easy to sit without understanding. But I see the it is same, right? You want to suppose you take 1000 now. That's what I told you just now. There is a change from 3.6 and 3.7 earlier up to 0 to 256. You can do one thing. You can download a 3.1 version or 3.2 version and test this one. So you take 1000 now and b equal to 1000. Now id of a and id of a b. Let us see what it gives here. This is changing, right? Okay, means until which value probably we can just see the byte collection because that gives you a perfect idea for us. Okay, and 256 it's same. Might be you can take up to a equal to some 300. Let's just try this. A equal to 300. Sorry, b equal to 200 and id of a and id of a b. This gives clarity for us. This is changing. Okay, then I'll take from 257 probably because I take 256, right? 0 to 256 we are assuming there's those objects as what by default immutable objects. What objects are immutable? Are you following? Immutable means they don't change at memory level. Anyhow, let me just try 257. That gives us clarity. B equal to 257. Now let us try id of a and id of a b. Observe this. Might be I need to correct my statement. I told you the from latest version some change is there, but let us see this. Yes, this is correct statement only. Might be somewhere I in some other language might be, but still not an issue. Let me correct my statement. See, this is correct, perfect statement. What is that? Until 256, 0 to 256. From 257 onwards, objects becomes immutable. Okay, but up to 256, these numeric objects are what? These integer objects are, what are they? They are immutable. You see, if you assign same value for multiple variables, all these objects will hold the same address. That is the point. And we had discussed that in the last session also. I had shown you how addresses are same for string. Okay, immutability concept I had explained. Same immutability concept you can apply for integers. Okay, till this. Got it right? Huh? Any questions on this? So fine. Next time I'm switching to the next topic. If you have any questions, we'll discuss that at the end of this session. Okay. Now let me introduce you the collections part. First thing, what is a collection? Why do we need collections? Very important topic. But before that, you got clarity, right? Even immutability is applicable for what? Number type, not just for string. Usually it will be up to what numbers, sir? If it is integer, it is up to 0 to 256. Okay. And even you can try for float and all this. In the same way, you don't need to, you know, ask me questions like, you know, sir, what about float? Just try, give some values, a float values, and see like a equal to 1.0, b equal to, you know, 1.0, and just say id of a and id of this. You can try it, right? Is there any difficulty? Give two float values and see what addresses are written here to check the immutability. Is the address changing or it is same? So that's what this is applicable only for. What this immutability there? For what? For string and num integer. But for float, what is that? This is changing. For complex, anyhow, you don't need to try. Complex also you can try this. Sorry, you can try for complex also. Let me finish this before going to the, because it will be clear for all of you. For boolean, you take a boolean value a equal to true. How this immutability is applicable for, because you know true means one, false means zero, you know that, right? And id of a, let's try this, and id of b, let's try this. These both are integers, right? Both are integers. Integer is within your what range? 0 to 256. Then obviously it returns what? They are immutable. Are you following what I am trying to tell you? So this is a little bit a deeper topic. See, those who want to really understand something, for them it is, you know, it will be interesting. Okay, because when we go little deeper, you have to be little patient. Got it right? And similarly, you can try this. Try for what complex? Take a complex, two same complex number. Check whether they are same, whether it is returning a same address. Then it means that, you know, the immutability concept is applicable for complex numbers also. And it is a clear, we had very clear picture now. For strings, obviously by default they are immutable for any value. For integers, the immutability is applicable to 0 to 256. And even the same is applicable for true value if it is within the range of what? Because, you know, all values except 0 is false for, isn't it or not? So suppose you take 300. Now, what do you say? For true or false, I cannot give 300, right? But you can do casting, that is possible. Any positive value within what? Within minus infinity and plus infinity, with except 0 are all true values. And 0 is false, that's all. Whenever situation comes, I'll give that also analysis. But for now, you can remember this. And last one, I am also trying complex so that it will be clear for all of you. 1 plus 2j. B equal to, again, same object, 1 plus 2j. Why I should give this? Because I told you earlier, complex should have a prefix j only. You cannot use whatever prefix you want. That too, it has to come as a, it's not prefix, I am sorry, suffix. It has to come as what? Suffix. Prefix means comes before, after. I think it's clear, right? So now, what you have to do, id of a and id of b, definitely. Okay, definitely it gives a clear picture here. So what is that? There is a difference here. So whenever, you know, you don't need to get confused. Whenever you are trying to assign same value to multiple variables and all these variables are returning same address, means it is in immutability zone. Which zone? You can conclude that clearly. There is no confusion here. Practically, we have seen it. If addressers are changing from a variable to variable, even the values are same like this, means they are what? Mutable. Is this clear? No? Numbers we can have, collection of booleans we can have. Somebody might ask me, can I have a mixture of all this, sir? Yes, why not? Collection is that. But how exactly collections are useful in real time? That is second question. What kind of data will come and how we process these collections? That is another scenario. Do we always get mixed data or do we prefer this homogeneous data? Homogeneous means same type. Are you following this one? It's an interesting only. Whatever I have discussed so far, it's a bit of basic. Then I try to explain it with the proofs itself. I had explained with proofs so that even if I am just trying to miss something, we can get it back in the discussion itself. So collection is what can I say definition now? How do you define collection? So group of values. Okay, it can be homogeneous or heterogeneous. So collection is a group of what is that? Values in one object. In how many objects, sir? One object again. Every value is an object. These values go and sit in another object, like here. This room is an object. Inside that, all of us human beings are collection values. Again, every human being is a collection. Every human being is an object, sorry. Every human being is an object, isn't it? Like that. So that is one thing. How collections are useful for us? If you want to group large amounts of data, then these are useful for us. Got it right? So now actually, we have these types, bytes, that is one type. And similarly, array byte array is one more collection. These are very basic. We don't use this much in the coding of your projects, okay? But in some cases, whenever you are trying to do data conversions, this might be useful for us, byte and byte arrays. There are a few occasions or situations where we need to use this. Then after that, List is one thing. This I use it regularly. Start, can we have mute? We have some music coming, okay? What I suggest is mute your machines so that. Right now, I'm talking about something. Suddenly, you know, list is something which I regularly use, and even map is something which we need to use, because you get data sets usually even in data science are big data, because I am connected to these areas. Okay, so I am talking more on this. So when you get these files like JSON is a key value pair. At such times we have to use map. There is a map collection for us here. List is one thing. Okay, and set is one more, map is one more. These are core collections. Once you understand these collections, even when we go to analytical Python, we talk about certain libraries like pandas or like numpy. There is a numpy which is similar to list. Okay, or there are some other areas. So if you have a good idea here, it's easy to analyze there. Okay, so let's start discussing now. We are very curious to understand. Okay, first thing, bytes. What is this byte here? Byte is again, see, when you say collection, it is collection of elements only, but this is precisely applicable only for integers. This is applicable only for what data?
Integers.
Integer data. This is strictly immutable. What is it? It is a strictly what, gentlemen? Immutable. Like, how we can test it? That's not something too difficult to understand. Now, how do I create a bytes collection? And this is having a limitation. Probably this should have values only from 0 to 256. Some range, fixed range is there. Okay. So you take a simple list here. Don't need to worry about this, list here right now. List is something which is in this square brackets. That is a list. We'll talk about list soon after finishing this. Today itself, we are going to have a very detailed and implementation of list in our sessions. So this is a simple list, and then pass it to the bytes constructor. This is actually, we can call this as a constructor too. This is part of some class actually, or you can call it as a bytes function or a method. Then a bytes collection object is created. Are you following this or not? Then you just print and see what happens. Open your machines and test this now. Okay, if you have any doubt, I will also show you. So now, if you see this, I'm just writing here, declaring here a simple example just to test it. This is actually idle. You know how to use idle, right? I taught you in the last session. Not last session, from many sessions we are doing this idle. This is fourth weekend. Which weekend is this? Yes. So now you take it something like a equal to some values here, 1 2 3 4 5. Okay, then I need what is that? I take bytes here, bytes of a, or you can directly create bytes in another way. I'll just show you. Now what I need is a print b. And also before that, I just want to cross check the type of this b variable. I want to make sure what is the implicit data type implemented for this. Obviously it's bytes only, but we'll check it. How do we check type of any data type? So print of what is that? We can directly use a type function in Python. That's why Python is so simple. Even the names are almost normal names, not something too sophisticated, too complex names. So that's why a regular learner can easily understand. I told you, right? If you didn't know, attend other sessions. Still, if you just concentrate, it's very easy to learn Python. Now, what do you do right now? Save this. What shall I do right now? Go to run. What do you do? Go to run. And then run module. And you can see it's giving me output as what the class is bytes. And by looking at this hexadecimal output, this is a kind of hexadecimal. I told you in the last session, hexa has a prefix x, and octal has a prefix o, and binary has a prefix ob, I hope. So like that. So, but still you don't need to worry. But how can I extract actual proper integers, sir? Because you told it holds some integer data. What is the point here? This bytes collection holds what data? Only integers. Then how do I get, when I print it, when I print the collection directly, I'm getting output like this. Then obviously there will be a little, what is that, you might worry a bit here, but there is nothing to worry at all. What you do is, whenever you get output like this, you iterate it, because internally the data is written to the bytes object. It is stored in bytes object. The list is stored into bytes form. If you want to, what is that, see proper output, what you can do, just iterate it. You know iterator, right? Which iterator I can apply on collections? For loop, right? In the last week we had a discussion about loops. So the best loop to apply on collections is for loop, more than while. We have just two loops here. We don't have so many loops like Java or C or C++. Then what you can do is, you just say for I in B colon, just print I. What happens? You see your expected values. Just run it. Perfect, right? Are you seeing the actual values which we had initialized to list or not? Are we getting right data now? So how to get the proper values from a byte collection, bytes collection, by iterating it. You understand, right? Yes or no? Clear, right? So this is one important thing. Suppose another important point is internal representation. So whenever we talk about collections, we need to know something called, what is that something? Internal representation. I taught this in strings. You remember, right? Do you remember or not? Whenever we declare a string, by default, that string has internally an indexing. What it has? And the indexing starts from 0 to n minus 1. And also it has two-way indexing, a positive and negative indexing. 0 to n minus 1 and n minus, and minus 1 to minus n. You got the point, right? So I will show you. You don't need to, you know, confuse here. This is our collection. Okay, it has these elements. 1, 2, okay, 3. I'll take bytes only so that you don't get confused. Bytes of, but you know, one thing is, this bytes doesn't take values directly. We have to pass an iterable object to bytes. Which object? And you can ask me a question. So what is iterable object here? It's not just list. Any collection which has a, what is that, group of values. Even string is also iterable. When you have group of values, it is called iterable object. Why? Definitely we need to apply iterator on such objects. Understood? Yes or no? So please mute your machines, folks. Okay, fine. So how these bytes look like? Bytes is something like this. I'll just take directly one. I took a collection here. I will show what if you directly assign values in the bytes method or bytes function, you get a compilation error. Okay. So what we do is now take this bytes, this thing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. How the indexing here is? If you learn indexing for this, it is same for list, it is same for tuple also. But for certain map, anyhow, they don't have indexing, because they use something called hash code. We talk there, okay? We'll talk about it there. It has something like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is indexing. What indexing? Positive or negative? Do you have another indexing or not? What is that other indexing? Minus 1, minus 2, and then minus 3, and then minus 4, and then minus 5. Are you following? The indexing will be like this. Got it right? Yes, sir. No? Nobody is answering. Means there are two things here. Either you are not following or no. Practicing is that is one more thing. So, somewhere online you can type in the chat box. Okay, this is how indexing is. Okay, let's expand this also on top. Okay, that's clear. You got idea about how the indexing is initialized in memory? This is how it is. If you ask me, how do you know? I had followed Jim's what is that guide of one Rosumo from the Python community or from textbooks or websites. So now coming back to this point, this is how the internal representation of bytes look like. Bytes collection. Now how do you extract it? Element by element. Now we had seen extracting all the values by iterating it. Yes or no? Are you following or not? If you don't follow, I am not going to say anything, but I'll repeat it. Because there is no other choice for me. What do you do right now? Is it clear or not now? What we should do right now? What we have to do? What are the possible ways now? Either iterate it, then immediately we get questions like, you know, how do I extract each element, sir? In strings also, we have extracted individual elements, right? How did we do that? By using which operator? Slice is one option, but if I want to access slices for a group of subs, getting substrings. But if I want to extract an individual element, a character from a string, there is another way. What is that other way? By applying index operator, right? Same thing. Apply indexing for this also. How? It is something like this. Your variable name syntax. If you want syntax, it look like this, guys. Your byte variable of what is that? That index. Over. For example, my byte variable is B. How do I extract 4 from this collection? Not fourth index, 4 from collection. And it has an index on top of that. What is that? 3. But in program, you have to analyze this in your mind, okay? If you want to get some index, how do you get it? Only by doing some analysis. So, if I say B of 1, I get what? 0. Sorry, B of 0 means I get 1. Sorry. B of 1 means I get 2. So these values are different. Okay, don't worry about this. B of 3 means? Sure? B of minus 2? I think you can see here it's 4 only. It is minus 2, it's 4 only. What about applying slicing? Can we apply slice operators on these collections? Slicing means, you know, slice is an operator. We can extract a part of collection, even string also, substring. If you want to get a part of a collection, which we call sub collection, we can apply slicing. Slicing is applicable on string. It is applicable on bytes. It is applicable on tuple. It is applicable on list. You remember this. It is not applicable on set and map. Okay, so let us test it once quickly. What shall I do here now? I can just apply slicing here. Sorry, index. I apply what? Index operator. What is that? Something like print of B of what, folks? B of 1. Or B of 0, anything is fine. What do I get now if it is B of 0? What do I get? Just take this and then run module. What I have here? One. Got it right? This is how we get what, gentlemen? We get an independent element from a byte, a bytes collection. Same thing is applicable for byte array. Same thing is applicable for list. Same thing is applicable for string also. For this, do we need any prior knowledge here? Just concentrate, you understand it. Are you following this now? Next after this. Same thing, you can try for remaining also. Try for extracting 2, 3, 4, 5 also. Can you test it once quickly in your laptops? Test it quickly. Test it, prepare notes for yourself besides this, running notes, so that you can remember it. And when you review, revise also, when you look at your notes, your brain recollects quickly than this materials, all this stuff. Clear, right? Next one. Similarly, do what? B of a 1, B of 2, B of 3, B of 4. Can I iterate this now with normal loop through index? We can apply for loop, specialized loop on collections. Another way of iterating is you can also use while. While is useful, best useful to us when you have that index. Okay? If through index, you can even iterate this collection with while. That is also possible. You understand the point, right? Yes, sir. Right. So that is one more important thing. Next one. Just run this. All of you tried this? Someone who is online, please test it, sir. Test it yourself online. You can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 coming here. One through loop and one through which one?
Index.
Through index. Can I apply slice operator? Can I apply slice on bytes? I told in the beginning of this bytes introduction, it is purely immutable. What is it?
Immutable.
Immutable. So when something is immutable, when you try to modify it frequently, it will create a new object. Yes, sir. So that's why what this Python people have done is they made it, you know, slice is not applicable on bytes. Suppose you see here, I want values from 2 to 3. I just need this particular collection. Okay, which collection? See here, observe carefully. What collection I need here? 2, 3. If we can apply, of course, slice is not applicable. But still, if we can apply slice on bytes, tell me how to extract this 2, 3. You know, slice from strings topic, right? If you are new for slice operator, I will introduce now one more time. It is very simple. It has, you know, brackets. Inside that, there is a start point and end point. That's all. That is slice. Is it difficult to understand? No, right? So, suppose I just need only what values? Print of here, because this is idle. If it is a prompt, I can directly test it. No need of print. If you use print, nothing happens in prompt. But here we must and should use this print when you are using IDEs. Okay. So B of what? What is the index of 2? Start index? 1 colon. What is the end index? Are you sure? So that's all. This is slicing. It looks like this, folks. Var name. Okay, I'm just giving syntax here itself because some of you are new here. Start index. That's why I recommend you to be regular to the sessions. And then end index. Okay, sorry. That's all. End index is what? is it included or excluded? If you put something like, you know, B of 1:5, suppose, just an idea, 1:5, it will take up to from 1 to, it will take from 1 to 4 and exclude what? 5. Are you following this or not? And this 1 and 5 are what? Are these values are indexes? Now you have to be careful. Don't give values and again, don't look at that and this is not coming, this is not coming. It won't come. How it will come? It's clearly there in the index, I mean syntax. What in syntax is saying here, I'm giving you syntax also here. It's quite a small example besides this. It's a crash course, okay? So now got it, right? Is it difficult to understand this very big operator? Slice is very simple operator. Kamal, you get this? See, here for 8th class student, slice and all, this is nothing. Yes, sir. Right. So, clear now? No, I'm just saying 8th class in sense, just to, what is that? Make you celebrity here, okay? That's all. Clear now, guys? And let me run this and just, so finally, this will give us a, usually, do you think this will work first thing? Question one, does it works? Obviously, in the first question itself, answer is no. Then there is no meaning moving forward. Is it yes or no? But still, why we are doing this? If at all, if we can apply, how, what is the output we get? Second thing, we concluded that it is not possible. Still, we are not sure. Then what we do? Test it. The only option for us is, you don't need to depend on anyone. You don't need to believe my sentence or statements. Just go to the IDE, just say run. What it's giving us? It's giving, actually it's returning. 1 minute. So earlier we used to get errors. 1 minute. What is the example we took here? Some reason, one minute guys, okay, if it is working, that is also fine, not an issue. That's why we are testing, isn't it? Bytes of x, then how to get this y of, I just need 2, 3, y of 1:3, 1, 2, 3, okay. So this is working. But earlier, if I remember, what is this? In the previous versions, because the version which I have used might be the earlier versions. That's why, you know, I have clearly documented. I'll check with previous version and test it and update you tomorrow, because tomorrow we have a session anyhow. And that is not difficult to test also. Take 3.1 or 3.2, if it is working or not. Might be from 3.6 or 7, there are major changes again in Python. So, that's why I put error with much confidence. But still, anyhow, the point is discussed, if it is working or not. Working means, is it supporting now? It's being supported now. Got it right? So I'll check and update you. If you have anybody has previous version here, like 3.1 or 2, all of you have latest versions only. Anyone from online? If you have a earlier version, can you try this slicing on bytes here? Of course, we know how to apply all that. We have a clear picture. Okay, that's it, fine guys. So finally, what is the point? I should remove this now, error. Should I or not? What is the conclusion? Now slicing is available for bytes also, right? Next one after this. You can also apply slicing in many ways, isn't it or not? Suppose you can say like this, print off. Now you can play with it in different ways. 1:3, one colon. I didn't give any end indexes. Can you see that? So what is the output I get now? I get what? 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay, just run this and then run module. But of course, again, slice gives us hexa output. What you have to do to convert it to your integer form, readable form? Either iterate it or index it. Okay, what you have to do? You have to initialize this result to some variable again. Shall I discuss that thing too for you? How to get, you know, that slice to readable form? Just you take another variable, some t1 equal to b of 1 colon something like this. Okay. Now this t1 has your part of that slice from the bytes. Now you can directly iterate it like this for I in t1. Are you ready for few programs right now? Okay, I'm going to give few assignments. Print of I. And then what you do? Run module. You got 2, 3, 5. So next program. Now you have a small task here. Are you ready for this? Which we have done earlier, but we are going to apply on collections. First program is something simple. Write a program. Just apply this. Write a program to find the sum of all elements from where? From bytes collection. So what? Okay, guys, I think you have done it right. Finding sum of all elements of byte. You take 5 or 10, it's your choice. Don't need so many. Now you iterate that bytes and extract each element from that and then try to do the addition. Can you try that? Did you finish, Mr. Kamal? Okay. Okay, let me show you how to do this. That's not something difficult. Already we have done this kind of logic, right, in the previous session. Okay. Right. I think I can keep this program like that, right? Think you know what? Could you tell me what changes you have to do to this code to find sum of two numbers? I mean, sum of all these. Should we declare one sum variable, right? Just say sum equal to 0, and then what should I do now? Go for a manual logic, okay? Sum equal to sum plus sir. Hey, that's all right. And print your. Thank you, Santosh. Sum or I should I print? How much I should get? 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5. Okay, so just run this. Okay, you got 15 or not? Don't worry about this hexadecimal output. I had clearly explained all the different use cases, like how to convert it to readable form, how to extract it through slice. The correction is, what is the correction? Earlier there is no slice is not supported, where I, whichever the version I have worked, otherwise error won't appear there. Okay, but in the latest version which I took, should be 3.7 or 8. Okay, 8, see, you can see there on the idle. So it is also supporting slicing. That is fine. I'll check and update on that part. So now, and how to extract individual elements from bytes? How did we get that? Seems like you had your breakfast today, right? See, I am missing out some energy here. What I need is a bit of energy. Okay, what you have to do? Show some energy in your faces. Okay, I'm just only trying to. I know it's not possible. Okay, is it clear now? Are you ready for next another approach? Can we apply range and iterate it? Another way of iterating. You know, we can use range, right? Do you remember range function? Once upon a time, in one weekend, we had discussed range function. Yes or no? Means for us, one weekend is very long, right? Whatever we learn in the weekend, that will be, what is that, out of coverage area in the next weekend. So, no, because I don't want to feel you bored, that's why I'm just there. But it's not possible continuously, right? Clear now? You can try like this also, because we had a clear understanding about range. From where to start, where to end, we can try this. You can also, there are functions we can apply. One more thing. This is the only function we can apply on what? We don't have much more functions on bytes. Let me just check what functions we can apply on bytes. First thing is, if you want to find length of bytes directly. You know, length function in strings, right? Do you remember? Why do we need length, gentlemen? We have discussed couple of functions, length, count, min, max. These are all, count is actually not part of this. I told you some generic functions in while discussing strings. If you don't know, someone is new, I will list out them and I'll tell you how to apply. In our session, if you are new also, I'm confident that you get most of the part. You don't need to worry that I don't understand this. So there are few functions. Let me try what our functions are applicable. Some x equal to, oh, not length of x, some l equal to length of x, because you cannot assign the same result to that variable. So what do you do now? Print l. How much I got here? How much I get here, gentlemen? 5 or not? There are 5 elements. How can I get 6? Somebody is saying 6 here. Out, please wake up. Time is what time is this? 11 o'clock, not no, 7 o'clock or 6 o'clock. No, I'm just joking. Don't take it serious. Clear no? Are you good or not now? Suppose we'll maybe let me try remaining functions. Max of x, min of x. Do you, is it difficult to answer these questions? What is minimum of x, sir? Okay, there are a few more functions like this. But among all these, which are important for us, these three are most useful. Length, max, min. Got it, right? So for more functions, what you can do? You can go for the Python community and then take the document functions. You can apply directly like this. See, when you know the approach of implementing, you know how to try for 3 functions, it is same for 10 functions. So it doesn't change. That process doesn't change. Only thing is, how that function works is just need to have a quick understanding. But as I told you, Python has straightforward function names. When you look at that function name itself, you understand what that function is doing here. Are you following or not? So that's all, folks. So you can test these 3, because I believe these are the most useful on bytes. So any more questions? Next one, another important point. What is that point? We cannot modify bytes because they are immutable. Then what is this statement? Let's test it. Because whenever we make a statement, make sure that you test that statement. Okay. So what do you do right now? you take values like this. Second thing, there are two tests we have to do. Usually first test, so I'm just giving you, make this point, gentlemen, okay? First test is, so I'm clearly going point by point. So what you do right now, again, take a list here, or you can directly create a bytes, say bytes of what? Another way of creating bytes is this, initializing to a variable, initializing iterable object to variable and passing it to bytes is one approach that we had seen so far. Another approach is what? You take a collection directly here. This is list. We'll talk more on this. When you move forward, you get many things. So something like 100, something like 400, something like 1000. You know, now we get something. We come to know something here. Enter. What it's saying here? Bytes must be within range what? Means, can I exceed more than that? In a bytes collection, at most we can store values from 0 to
256.
256 is end. After that, you cannot assign any other higher value here. Following or not? It's a clear picture for us. That is one thing, one observation. Second observation, you can make a note of all this, okay? Second observation, immutable in sense, you cannot even modify this bytes collection. Suppose X has so many values like this. Okay. So you can see one more difference here. Can you see the output now? What is the output it is getting right now? It is giving me as what? List itself. Earlier, if you see, when I take a list like this, one more another difference. See, these are all, you know, you can, when you are playing with this, you come to know about all this. Bytes of what? X. Now print Y. Can you see the difference here in the outputs also? When I directly pass, see the differences carefully. I told you to make points, because we cannot get everything in the websites, these things. While we are testing, we are coming up with all these things. When I give it as a direct collection, and I pass it directly to the bytes function, you can see when we print it, we are getting output in readable form, not in a hexa form. But when I, you know, take a collection and passing that collection, being casting, that is what casting. What is that? Applying a casting, we are getting output in another form. Can you see the difference? So this is one more observation. Third observation. Are you following or not? See, if you make a points, all these, it will become a beautiful notes again. Third one. So you have how many values in your bytes right now? 1, 2, 3? One. I'm sorry. Sorry. So why I got this hexa form? I got confused. Okay. Let me correct it. This X is actually the previous collection. Which collection? It is not. This one failed, right? Is this created first thing? This is actually, I thought this is a byte. Okay. So this is actually, I tried to give like this. It can take values only from what? From 0 to 256. That's all. Now when I print X, I was just assuming that it is collection. Which one? I am assuming bytes. But bytes is not created at all with this collection. Yes or no? There is a quick correction here. So what should we do then? What is this then? Earlier, I had initialized X equal to a direct collection. That collection is getting printed here. This is not actually, what is this? Bytes created. So bytes, this list of values are not created at all. So then what do we do then? X equal to, how do you correct it then? What range of values we have to keep in this bytes? 1, 2, 3. I can take up to what? Comma? 256. Can I exceed this? Okay. Still, why I am getting here? Means you take up to 255. Is it accepting? Even 256 is what? Excluded. Are you following or not? So this is one more. And finally, now you print X. Got it right? So correction is, what is that? See this what? You know, this is actually declared earlier. You remember, right? I thought just, you know, you got same output, no problem. always
I have one question here.
Yeah, we'll talk, we will get to your questions, you know, at the end of the session. So now, another one. Is it clear, right? Finally, next one, last one. Suppose some x equal to, I have something like this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then you know how to extract each element from this, right? X of 0. Then what is that? X of 2. Now, can I replace any value in this bytes collection? This is one more important point. Can I replace it? Shall I try it now? Suppose I want to replace a value. I just say x of 0 equal to some 100. Is it possible? Possible or not? Press enter. So what do you get? What do you? Of course. This is what? This is a collection. This is what? This is a collection. Now, why I took this? 1 minute, guys. I should not initialize it. What should I do now? I should pass it to b equal to bytes. So that is a pure collection, right? So it can be modified. Yes or no? It is just a collection. Can you see? It's a list, not a bytes. Now pass it to which one? Bytes. Now you say b of 0. Okay, then now again I am saying b of 0 equal to some, you know, some 200. Will it allow 200 here? Can I modify this value? Yes or no? Read the error now. What it's saying? Byte object does not support item assignment. It's correct analysis only. X earlier is a list, it is not bytes. So if you pass it to bytes, then it becomes a byte collection. Then I try to modify byte collection. What happened now? What happened? It's not allowing to change. That is, so it is strictly immutable. You cannot change even object in bytes. That is another conclusion. But you can change list. We can modify list. That is possible for list. We'll come to, we'll talk about it when we come to the list topic. Clear now? Right, that's all. So finally, we finished which topic? Bytes topic. Finally, let me conclude important the points which we have touched about bytes. One thing, bytes is a collection with which is an immutable object, and it can have values ranging from only 0 to 256. And third thing, can we modify this bytes collection?
No.
Fourth thing, okay, we can apply iterator as well as we can access elements through index. Yes sir, no. These are the observations about bytes. So next one. So same thing, we can try it for what? And one more important observation. What is that? Before going to byte array, can we have float values?
No.
We had a clear discussion. I told you in the beginning of this bytes, it can accept only integers.
Yes.
Are you following? Yes, sir. What functions we can apply on these bytes finally? Basic functions, like we can apply few functions like length, min, max, count, I'm not sure. Length itself gives you the count, number of values in the bytes. I don't think count is available for what? Count of what? Bytes. Sorry, count of b. So count is not defined. We don't have such function there. Okay. Maybe I'll try sum of b. We can apply sum function. These are aggregate functions. Sum, min, max. Average of b, one more function I can show you is average of b. What is this, sir? Average is not applied. You can check like this. So anyhow, this is enough on bytes. We have so much of time. We had discussed very in detail about bytes now. Finally, byte doesn't accept any other values except what?
0 to 256.
Except integers and 0 to 256. Are you good now? Does bytes have accepts a string? Another question. Another question to you. Does bytes accept a string? Yes, sir.
No.
Okay, I'll just test it. See, generally, you know, I have this very bad habit of testing everything. So that at least that gives you a clear picture to everyone. If anything is missing, also we can correct it there. Okay. So x equal to bytes of what? ABC. Do you think this will work? Bytes definitely accept iterable object. String is iterable. Yes or no? String is iterable. Yes or no? See, you have to understand this terminology also. Iterable means it has a group of values. Such objects are called what? Iterables. Now, what is this now? String argument without an encoding. Anyhow, string directly is not allowed where? In bytes. Clear, right? So that's the point. Now let us switch to the next topic. What is our next topic? Byte array. So I don't use much of these which one byte and bytes and byte arrays. Usually I deal more with what? List and map and set also I don't use much in my day-to-day activity. Okay, so this is only just for analysis purpose. Clear, right? Next one, byte array. Same, both are like twins only. The difference is, only difference is what? Both are twins. Twins in sense almost they are same, identical, but there are few differences. What are those differences? One thing, this is mutable. What is this, sir?
Mutable.
You can modify byte array. We cannot modify bytes. And rest of the things are same to same. Only difference is this is mutable, which is mutable byte array. Mutable means we can modify it. Bytes are immutable and we cannot modify it. Is it clear now? Okay. So that's all, guys. And you can test same examples. You can whatever we have tested for bytes, you can test for what? You can test it for what, gentlemen? Byte array. Are you good or fine? So next one. Okay. Next. I'll just show you that only difference here. How this is mutable, how byte array is not, how this is, which one? Byte array is mutable and bytes is immutable. Ready? You give me some example now. X equal to bytes, anyhow, I don't need to prove anything. Byte array of what? Take some values. Again, it has to, it will take iterable object only. Even byte array accepts what objects, sir? Iterable. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Shall I run this now? Print x. Then if I want to extract part of this, I can apply slice or not? Can I apply slicing? Also, we had discussed slicing in bytes function, isn't it or not? So even slice is applicable there itself, it can be applied on byte array. You are able to apply an immutable object. Still it's possible here also. So what do you do right now? Some x of, I just need 4, 5. What I need? 4, 5. What is the index of 4 now? Index of 4 is a 3 colon. I can leave it like this. This is one option. From there, I just hardly have only two values. If I want something in the middle or something in the middle, in the beginning, from the beginning part, you have to, you must and should mention the, what is that, start and index. Okay. So, but this is used in different ways. I have taught you in the previous session. So you got 4 and 5, and that is one possibility. Second possibility is, can we, is it mutable or immutable? Suppose you say x of 0 equal to some 100. Do you think this gets, you know, this will replace that 1 or not? 0 has what? 0, this has indexing. Same indexing is applicable for, I told you, right? We have an indexing for bytes. Same indexing is applicable for byte array. Even for list also, even for tuple also. All these are indexed data structures, including string. Which are all indexed? String, then bytes, then byte array, then list, and then tuple. All these are what kind of data structures? Indexed. Are you following this now? Next one. Enter. This time I didn't see any error. We cannot modify object or no, not possible to change object. Something is not saying. Now you print X. Okay. 100 is nothing but hexa. I told you, right? It is stored in which form? Hexa form. In hexa form, 97 is A. 98 is what? B. 99 is what? 100. Sorry, 99 is C. And 100 is D. That's what it is written in. You don't need to worry about it. Some kind of what is that internal hexa? Don't worry about it. Now, what if I want to see the actual, you know, readable values for IN? Which one? X colon. Just you just need to print it. Print off. When you are using this idle or, you know, command prompt, indentation is very important. Follow the indentation. And this time you see 1 or 100. Earlier when I created the byte array, my value, the first value is 1. Then when I modified, now 1 is replaced with 100. It's a clear proof that this is what? This is mutable. Are you following or not? We are done almost. And other, again, few more observations. What about the range? Is it same like 0 to 256? Will it accept only values from 0 to 256 or more than that? That is one question. Second question is, what is the second question? Can we have heterogeneous elements inside bytes, byte array? Heterogeneous means different type of data, but actually this is homogeneous. Bytes is homogeneous, right? It accepts only what data? Integer or something related to integer form. Even byte array follows the same or is it different? I told you, it's both are almost same in many ways, except there are few differences here. So suppose you just test it once for, you know, observation purpose. You give 500 at the end here, it's showing an error. And one more change is, can I have decimal values inside this? No. These points are intact. There is no change in these features. They are same there. Okay. Are you good now? Shall we switch this to another, you know, the very important collection in Python? The most used in the day-to-day project work is list. You know, even while doing comparison of data sets, you know, in our project regularly, I use list only. Otherwise, advanced, if you go to advanced Python, like analytical Python, the easiest way is applying pandas. NumPy's all that. Got it, right? So that's why once we finish this, we apply this on machine learning also. So that, you know, you get an idea how these collections are related to machine learning and how they are applicable in analytical Python. So that a comparative analysis gets you a quick understanding. Got it, right? So now, ready for list now? Let's get into the list now. So far, are you good? Next, list. Concept is same. This is also indexed data structure. List is mutable or immutable? While testing bytes, we concluded something. I told you, we'll talk again. I told you to remember, again, we'll discuss this point, okay? List is immutable. Sorry, list is mutable. Mutable in sense, we can modify the elements inside list. Okay. List is just like an array in other languages. So, see, generally we know that it, whenever we use this index operator, index in sense that brackets, guys. What is that? That brackets, we are using it, right? So this one, this is index operator. Usually this is how, this is the operator people use in all languages to declare arrays. And list is a kind of array, but dynamic array. What array? If you don't know array, simple values which you declare inside this bracket separated with comma, that is array. And this values has indexing starting from 0 to n minus 1 and minus 1 to minus n. Two-way indexing is there for all these indexed data structures in any dances. In what? Exactly, in Python. String has two-way indexing, right? Negative, positive. Bytes has two-way indexing or not? Did we tested it or not? Byte array has two-way indexing, right? And a list has two-way indexing again. We'll see that, nothing to worry. And we can construct list in different ways again. We'll come to that point. How do we extract elements from list? Obviously through, when you have index, indexing for any data structure means we extract elements from such data structures only through indexes. That's a very simple thing, right? Next one. And obviously index starts from 0 to n minus 1 and minus 1 to minus n, two-way indexing. Left to right, right to, are you following, guys? Okay, list supports homogeneous and it's not, this is not like bytes and byte array, because you have observed clearly, right? Now you are slowly understanding things, right? Are you following or not? Earlier in the, when we start bytes, you might felt little, what is that, new, and everything is, you know, whenever we analyze something, it is in the analysis phase. But now with that basic foundation, it's easy to understand list. It supports what? Homogeneous and heterogeneous, whereas bytes and byte array are only homogeneous. They accepts only, are you sure? And they has a limitation. What is that limitation? But list don't have limitation, it is unlimited. Like Jio has unlimited offers, right? Once upon a time, I'm not sure still it exists or not. But if Jio is unlimited or not, but list is unlimited. You got clarity, no? This is only just to, what is that? Quickly get some understanding. List is dynamic. Dynamic means it is like Mr. Vinayak. No, who is Vinayak? How much hour food you give to him, he will eat, keep on eating only. Yeah, Ganesha. When I can sense, who will be there? He will be only that.
That's Swami Vivekananda.
That's fine. Now you have to come out of that. What is that? You have to wake up now. Okay. Right. Anyhow, clear, guys? Are you okay? No, yes, no, no.
Yes, sir.
Give me something. Yes or no? One answer. So, how many ways we can create list here? The very basic way is this. Most of the time we use this. What is this? Through index. Another approach is through list constructor. What constructor?
List constructor.
If it is difficult for you to pronounce constructor, remember it as list function, otherwise list method. But list method is more or less, it's actually, you know, it's a typecasting function. It's a casting function. What function?
Casting.
Have you ever heard of casting function in Python? I taught you a topic called type conversion. To convert anything to int, which function do we use? Int int function, right? To convert anything to float, we use which function? Anything to complex? Anything to list, which function we should use? List function, or, you know, list constructor or list method, you call it as it is, but technically it is a called list constructor. Whatever the methods we apply, casting functions, they are called constructors. What do you call them as? A technical. Understood? But if it is too technical, you remember in your own way. Okay, that's not something problem for us. See, when you, the point is, implementation matters more for us. How you remember is your choice. How you apply is very important. Okay, next. But anyhow, we'll go one by one. First, we'll talk about what? Index. Then we'll talk about list one by one. so that you get a better understanding. So when you compare it with bytes or byte array, what differences we can see here? It is heterogeneous, it is dynamic. How about the order of elements? Order of elements is same for any indexed data structure. Following or not? Order in sense, in whichever the order you insert, same order we get it. But for set and map, they will change. Order will change for set and map. Then we didn't discuss that, right? So remember this, that's all. If you want to forget, forget it also. Which one? About set and map. But remember about list. Order is preserved or not? Yes or no? Duplicates, can we put duplicates in list? Yes or no? Duplicates are allowed. Okay. So this is observation. Next, let's start creating one list first. How do you create list? Let's use index operator. Which operator?
Index.
So let's see this now. We can create list like this, folks. Okay, different ways are there, but let me show you first one. We are starting with index operator. X equal to inside this. You can take val 1. This is how, if you want syntax, val 1, val 2, val 3, comma, put dot 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 means so on. You can add how many ever you want. Okay. So for example, example is simple example I'm taking here. What is that? X of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If you want, you can take any values of your choice. If not 1, 2, 3, 4. This is a simple list. Now we have so many problems to solve this before going to talk about list constructor, how we construct a list with list method. We'll first work on this. This is my this thing. I'll just give some important inputs for you. Later on we implement some programs and we get a practical understanding like how this is really useful in our applications. Okay, so now X equal to, what value should I give here? Now with the experience you have today, if I want to extract values from this list, how many ways, in how many ways I can do that? One way, two way, three ways, how many ways I can extract? This has indexing or not? What, how many ways of indexing are there here? Forward and backward. Yes sir, do you agree or not?
Yes.
Okay, but let me just try put it down here so that someone who is new to this topic gets some understanding. So what is the forward indexing? Zero. Let's give some space so that it's easy to provide the indexing in Notepad. 1, 2, 3, and 4. One, this is from left to right. Right to left indexing, -1. So I say right to left because it is easy to remember. If you say left to right, again negative indexing, then you have to remember from -n to -1. Understood or not? So this is my algorithm to remember. You can have your own algorithm. Suppose for you, you can make your mind like this. So I have 5 elements. So index starts with what? -n means -5, -4, -3, okay, -2, -1. You can remember like that too. That's your choice. Okay. This is how, whenever we create any collection like this, this is how the indexing is created in memory. Now I want to extract element by element. How do I do that? I can extract in how many ways? Either through iterator or through index. So suppose I want to extract a specific element. What I want to do? I want to extract what element? A specific element. So how do I do that? X of something like this. If it is a syntax comes like this. See, if you are really bothered about syntaxes, okay, it's something like var name of what? Some index. This is how you extract an element from where? From a specific element, not all elements. Extract specific element. Okay, next. If I say x of 0, what is it? x of 1, x of minus 3, x of minus 4, x of minus 1. Following or not? Difficult? Okay. Now, shall we test this now? Can I modify this collection? Can I modify list collection? Is it mutable or immutable?
Mutable.
You have mutable order of elements, okay? But there are other few more things. See, you know, I try to get deeper into the analysis parts. Sometimes, you know, we are going beyond the line from the training curriculum, actually. In a training platforms, what there will be a boundary. Got it right? But we get out of that sometimes. So if you are curious about it, you have to do that. Clear now? So now we can just test it for immutability purpose. Okay, there are two ways to see this immutability. Whether the object is immutable, whether the object is mutable, or the elements in object are mutable. There are two points here. I told you, right? We are moving away from the boundary line. People don't touch this. You got my point? I gave a statement. What is that statement? Is object immutable or the elements in the object are immutable? There is a lot of difference in this. How do you test both? Exactly. That is one possible choice. How do you test other one? By modifying the elements. Replacing elements. There are two things here, right? Are you understanding this statement, sir? See, generally this is how I learn. I get core into the, whenever something is there, I try to get into the roots of that. Sometimes I might fail. I don't care. But the point is I get a better understanding of that. Got it right? That's why many people struggle in the industry while implementing. Because they only have idea about only the cream layer. They don't go to the bottom layer. Cream means a top layer only. So we'll do one thing. X equal to, again, what you do? Our friend has given a good answer. Now you try idea of X, how much? Idea of Y. This is how you can test for what? Object immutability. Which immutability?
Object.
Is it same or different? Means this is the object is mutable now. Object changing or not? Suppose if it is returning same address for both objects, then it is what? Immutable or mutable? Sir, this is for you only. See, in training, you know, there will be just syntax example. This much discussion doesn't happen, because first thing is, when you go beyond that, even for a trainer, it is a challenging thing. Got it right? So your awareness and consciousness is very important here more. So next one after this. So suppose I say now there is a conclusion here. What is that conclusion? It is object is mutable. Elements in object, can I modify now? Another thing. Without any doubt, we can tell that. Yes. So x equal to, I am taking it what? And write print x. Are you following? Yes, sir. So that's it, guys. So this is first thing. Extracting specific element through it. You know, modifying this. Also, this gives you an idea how to extract through index. I had modified which one? Something in zeroth index. Suppose I want a second element, you can say x of 2. I want element from third index, x of 3. I want all elements, x. What should I print? I want element by element. Then what is the possible choice now? I want element by element. What do I do for I in x? See, you should be like, whenever you take something, try it in different possibilities. You got the point, right? The reason is, might be you might think already it's getting right, why to test all this? Without your notice, your thought process keeps improving. You don't know that. If you want to become a good programmer, you don't need to be intelligent. You don't need to be intelligent in the beginning itself. Because I am not confident about programming when I'm, when my in my graduation. You got the point, right? For me, data type is very challenge, big challenge. I'm not saying I am too great now. Okay, I'm good. Right? So point is simple. Apply and try to implement in different ways. So now print off what? Suppose, can I try this with while loop also? If it is, if I want to apply while, how can I apply while on this X? You know, you have an idea about while loop, right? How do I apply while loop on this list? First we need initialization, then we need a condition, and we need a, do we need to apply all that sorts of things or not? I'll do one thing, I'll do this in idle, iterating through while loop. Someone iterating for is simple, because you pass that, you know, there are only two, what is that? You have to give two things in this for. One is what? The dummy variable. Second one is the, you know, the collection. Then you iterate it element by element. You get it into the I and you print it. But how do you apply while here? Test it now. So that's what, when you keep thinking in different ways, automatically we get a better understanding of how we apply it. You got it right? You say I equal to 1 now. Should I start with 0 or 1? This is my collection, folks. You keep answering me. How to apply while now? How to apply while? First, do I need initialization for while or not? Yes. When to start? Should I start with 0 or should I start with 1? This time, my initialization has to be what, gentlemen? Why should I start with 0? Because I should start iterating from where? 0. So 1 in sense, the index of 1 is 0. By default, this index data structures always has a starting index 0, ending index minus 1, blind thing. Or if you want to go for minus n, sorry, ending. If you want to go for negative indexing, minus 1 to minus n, or minus n to minus 1. If you want to go from left to right in both directions, it is minus 1 to minus n to minus 1, that's all. And slicing, another important, we'll come to that slicing part again. Okay, we will slice as much as possible, right? So now how do I apply while? Can I, you know, already we have learned a couple of generic functions. If I want to get length of, you know, a collection, I told you in strings also, we can apply length on all these indexed data structures. What data structures? Okay. On all these data structures. So how do we apply length here? No? Can I need, do I need length here? Yes. Easiest way is using which function? Built-in functions. So first get length now. That's easy, right? Now I can see the, you know, the size of array, and I know that it starts with 0, ends with 4. Suppose if it is having at least some 10,000 objects inside that, list. At such times, do you think it's easy to count it manually? Best option is what? Go for length. So what do you, how do you do that? So some len, some l equal to what? Len of x. It is same. The way we apply this length, min, max, okay, sum, these are all aggregate functions. I think this has average also, we'll test it. These are almost similar way. Don't try to call something like x dot. There is a small correction, let me initialize. I told you while talking about strings, you remember, right? If it is inside string, you have to invoke it. We have to call it through reference or object of that, something like s dot or x dot or y dot. If something not part of that API, string API, you have to directly apply like this. This is not part of your list API. It is a common function. It's a regular normal function where we can directly pass our value to this. Are you following this? we have to observe these differences whenever we are applying. Understood now? So while, what should I do now? I less than or equal to L, whatever is, see, it's your choice. You come from left to right or right to left. It's okay. As long as you know what you are doing, it's fine, sir. Okay, I equal to I plus one. Then am I done, right? This is exactly what did I say? Ah, yeah, true. What this loop will yield, what it yields me? It will yield 0 to 5. But I have to iterate up to what? I minus 1, because index will be up to n minus 1, right? Or you can take it as n otherwise for easy understanding. But this time I don't get, you know, exact value. Suppose I take here to be more clear, my values are 10, 20, 30, 40 and 5, leave it 5. Suppose if I iterate this loop, what do I get? Do you think that I get 10 to 5? Zero. I get 0 to 4. What do I get?
Zero.
Suppose if I want to extract element from this list, what should I do, gentlemen? I should not say I is just a loop variable. You know how to extract element from this list we had discussed so far from last week, this week. No, if it is bytes or byte array or, you know, list, we have to say that variable of a index. Am I giving that variable name here? From where I should extract this? I should say x of a I. Thank you, Sandeep. Clear, right? This is how we should extract elements from where? From any collection, indexed data structure, not just only from list, from any indexed collection. That we should not forget this. Are you clear? Right. So this time I think we get good output. Run this. Got it, right? Now this is. So we have done different ways of iterating it, extracting data from list now. Are you ready for some programs? Would you like to implement few programs here? Yes sir, no? Okay, let's do it now. Chalo. Okay. So now, write a program. I'll give so many programs. This time you have lot, so many things in your plate. Are you good with all this, right? Analysis things. Write a program. To print even numbers from a list. Write a program to find sum of numbers in a list, all numbers, sum of elements in a list otherwise. Okay, next one. Write a program. What is that? We'll do like this. Huh? Sum and multiplication, yes, of course, that's simple. If you put into in some place, write a program. Okay, try that also. Those are all simple functions. To find product of elements, product of elements of a list. I'll give more. These are all only basic level. Use for each here. Use for, that is best choice for us, more than while. You can also apply range function if you want, okay? Whenever it is necessary, take the support of which function? Range. And all other functions we have learned so far in the API. Length, min, max, all that stuff. And when I say min, max, okay? So without using a built-in function, again, there are few use cases to you know. Without using built-in functions, length or min or max, what do? Write a program. What should we do now? To find the count of elements of a, to find what, gentlemen? Count of elements of a list. How many elements are there? Program to find max element from a list. Don't use any built-in functions. Don't use any built-in functions. Okay. If it is built-in, there is nothing you do. I want you to implement this yourself without support of existing functions. Write a program to find min of elements from a list. Or minimum element of list, max element of list. Program to find average of all elements of a list. You know, this is one simple algorithm in machine learning. What is that? Mean, what we call it as. Finding average is nothing but what we call mean. You can parallelly start applying that also here. What is that now? Program to find, write a program to find, I'll directly say mean of all elements, mean of all elements from a list. You know median, right? Do you have idea about median? What is median? Yes, finding exact middle end. Suppose if middle ends elements are same, means find average. See how good you are. That is one more algorithm of one more basic principle of machine learning. Mean, median, okay. What about mode? Whichever element has a maximum frequency, that becomes the mode. Will you try all this yourself now? Why don't you try these basic algorithms, apply here itself in collection? I told that only in today's in yesterday's that you know our this thing advertisement also applying collections with for machine learning. It doesn't come separately here. Things are there here only. Got it right? Even machine learning is nothing. They are also algorithms. People say in different names and they'll give some fancy names and talk so much. At the end of the day, everything is an algorithm. Everything is a code internally implemented. But those algorithms are more intelligent than the regular algorithms. Got it right? Next one. So find mean, find mode, write a program. So you need some challenges, right? To find a mode of, okay, elements of what? Usually we take in the form of list only to do all this kind of analysis part. People use what? A kind of arrays only. And last one is write a program to find. So I am introducing slowly what the basics of this machine learning algorithms. Everybody know the formula, but how to apply, the approach of applying is something you need to learn. That's all. Find mean, median, median of a list, mode of a list. Okay, can you try these programs for now? By solving last three itself, it will take at least 15 to 20 minutes if you are fast enough. Otherwise, today is enough. At least it will take 1 hour or 2 hours. But prior to that, you need to have a clear picture about what, how to play with the collections, how to play with loops, nested loops. If you know all that, then you can play with all this. You got it right? I told you every time we are going to apply in our sessions, okay, because as we are getting some introduction to the concepts, it took time. Again, from now, tomorrow, and we have a rigorous implementation. Those who thinks you want a pure practical approach, then this is going to be very useful to all of you. Right now, first to five are nothing, even sixth one is nothing. Mode, even last two are nothing. Only while finding mode, you have to see how, like how to get occurrences. And if you don't know, I will give you approach of doing it step by step. Prior to that, what kind of problems we should solve to come to the mode part. I will introduce you know, the basic logics we should solve to come to the mode. Okay, so are you good now? So I suggested to bring your laptops. So at least what you do is at least try to solve in your books. You need to have that that thing to apply, the zeal to apply, then only we get best out of these sessions. Okay. Yeah, thanks for many answers here. I am seeing so many answers from different people. Many people had you know, asked me many questions, but all your questions I think we had tried it, right? So what is the need of converting a list to a byte and then accessing it, please? Oh, it's a simple thing. So first thing, understanding the nature or behavior of the function. Subba is there, right? Don't know, let me just see if he is available. Is it? See, for any, you know, make sure you give these details. Okay, I'm just solving few of this now. I'm taking the very difficult program, first program. Okay, let me try to do this. Finding even numbers. Now I'm changing the mode here, mode of applying. I'm not using while. I don't think there are few questions also here from the chat box, sir. Before going to do this, sir, the chat box answers question, sir. Why we use bytes instead of list here? Okay, that is one question. Okay, why we need to convert a list to a byte and then access it? Okay, see, there are certain cases, you know, answer for this is when you are trying to do some serialization, deserialization. Okay, converting data to the bytes is more recommended than using it as a list. That is this thing. Okay, why we need to convert it. Second thing is, whenever we are trying to introduce something, what kind of methods were there? Okay, what methods were there and how to apply those methods? Understanding those methods is the first priority for us. Later on, how question comes? Which question? How question? Suppose if you talk about list, even list constructor, to the list constructor you cannot directly pass values. You have to pass a list as a indexed list as a parameter. These are all casting functions. What functions, sir? These are all casting. Casting means they used to convert any type to the required type. Are you following this point? Or listen to this point, those who are new here. Gentlemen, just listen. There is a question coming from the friends from online. So whenever we have something like bytes, okay, or something like byte array, something like list, something like str, something like into. These are all casting functions in the first place. What functions, sir?
Casting.
Why do we need casting, you tell me? It's a very basic question, simple question also. Why do we need casting? Whenever we are working with certain type of data in real time, suppose bytes and byte array is very rarely used, but they are used in cases like when you are doing certain kinds of low level coding. What coding?
Low level
in sense when you are doing something right related to the operating system, something related to motherboard kind of programming, chip level coding. You can do chip level coding with Python. Do you know that Python can be used to implement chip level coding? When you are doing with such kind of this thing, so using more than as a list, converting to bytes is recommended, because byte is very near to which one? Your motherboard, this thing. Yes, got it right, huh? It is more compatible at low level. So this byte and bits, yes or no? So which is the nearest? First is bit, then after that which is the nearest byte, after that next it is something like that. So converting bytes always, what is that, makes machine to understand, to get it a quicker analysis. Are you following? The easiest word is not to confuse. When you deal with such kind of chip level coding, converting data to the bytes is more recommended than using as it is. Are you following this? So using this octal and hexa code in such levels is much more recommended. Binary, there are three different ways. What is that? When you're dealing with low level coding related to the operating system or motherboard coding or chip level coding, all this needs this kind of casting, conversion of data. Got it right? In such cases we prefer that. But when you are working on high level applications like big data, like data science, more than using bytes or byte array, we prefer to use which one? List or map, these are more popular. Are you following? I think somebody has answer here now. I think if he is there. Got it right? So now anyhow, let's switch to this one. And other question somewhere, what is that? Other question somewhere, what is it? Few more questions were asked. Those questions, you got it answered directly in the discussion itself. What is bytes in sense? It's a collection which holds data. We have a detailed discussion again. After all that discussion, why we use bytes instead of list here means, when you have a limited data and if you want to make it immutable, you don't want to allow change data, then we prefer which data structure? Which data structure should I prefer here? Byte. So when you want unlimited data and you want to keep modifying data, then you need to prefer which one? When you observe all the differences, whichever we have discussed in the session, that itself is giving a clear picture when to apply bytes and when to apply list. We had discussed each and every point in detail, right? That is itself is giving a clarity for us. When should we use bytes? Why somebody is asking a question here? Why we use bytes instead of list here? Why we use bytes? We don't use bytes, sir. Every now and then, bytes are used in very few situations wherever we need a limited data. That too, we don't want to allow people modify such data in such case. Second thing, when you are going for low level coding, like I told you, chip level coding, people prefer which kind of data structures, sir? Bytes or byte array? They don't prefer which one? List. When you have huge data, again, there also you have to use list only. Got it right? Huh? That's the point. Is it clear now? So, and what else about slicing? We'll come to that part. We didn't completely implemented slicing, gentlemen. Bytes are homogeneous only. That's what we had discussed. That might be if you had just all that is discussed, Mr. Ram. Seems like you just came now. Okay, when you talk about bytes, it is immutable. Okay, it is a byte array is immutable. We had discussed all that. Okay, fine. Now, because I just want to give some time for these questions, let me just try this first one. Finding what is that printing what? Even numbers. How do I print it for I in x colon? What should I try here? If we had already tested this, if divide this by 2 and if it is equal to 0, what we have to do? Print of what, gentlemen? Okay, then enough, right? Do I need to do anything here? Just that's all over, right? This is a simple program finding even numbers. Got it right? But I hope all are even numbers in the list except 5. But still, it makes difference or not? Next program. What is that next program finding? Sum of elements of a list. Sum of elements of a list. Shall I give you an easiest way? Something which you don't need to put your brain itself, brain at all. What is that? Print of sum of x. This is a built-in function, folks. What function? Okay, it is a function method. Whenever you see brackets with some name, it is a function or a method or a constructor. Okay, all these are falls under the category. So now what do you do right now? You got 105 here. Can you see this? So now again, what else, sir? Again what? No need of count now. Same sum I have to implement with what? A code. That sum function also has same code, similar code, if not same, similar code. Take one sum variable or sum s equal to 0, if not sum. Then what do I do right now? The easiest thing is s equal to s plus. I told you in the beginning session itself while doing basic logic, these logics are going to travel with you in many programs. Okay. Finally, what should I do right now? Print s inside or outside? You can print inside or you can print outside. If you print inside, you get incremental sum. If you print outside, you get total sum. That's all. I had discussed that also. Same output, right? When I was built in, it gave 105. When I write my code also, it gave 105. But if you know how to do this, then that is actually the real thing. If you are depending on some means, then always we can't get into the algorithm implementation. Got it, right? Next, we found some. Next one after that, min. How to find min? To find min, take one variable min itself. Assume that min is initially, what is that? Min is 0 or 1 minute. Get the first element, any one element from this, okay? No. You get elements directly. So set it to some default value. So if, what is the array here? Iterator. I is there. You get some value from this 10. Now what do you have to do? You have to compare them with the remaining all elements or not. So what do you have to do? If I less than, I'll do one thing. I'll take this as x of 0. Okay. Now, what I'm checking for, I'm checking for min. So I get I. Suppose 10 is less than something in this. If I less than min colon, then what should I say? Min equal to I. Huh?
So when you ascend min is equal to x of 0, it will likely ascend 10 to min, right?
The first element, default element, I am trying to get it. So then what you do right now? You iterate point by point. Now initially you get 10. 10 less than 10. True or false? False. This won't exist. Then you get what? 20. 20 less than min? Yes. Not x of I. You know, you can try and see. Your x of I is for while loop. Which loop? While loop. So you are in the same. What you are thinking with that index only. Without index also you can find it. 20 less than min, true or false? Here you don't need x of I, gentlemen. Do I need x of I? You can directly take this. Assume that initially the first value is min. Iterate it. Understand the algorithm. Iterate it. First get 10. Then check the condition. This is important here. Iterating is nothing. First value less than min. I'm just trying to see. Now 10 less than 10 is what? Not true. Then if it is true, then only this leave it. Then again you get 20. 20 less than min, true? No. And again 30 less than min, true? No. 40 less than min, true? False. 5 less than min, true. Okay, that is also fine, but still min equal to I. Okay, this will work, of course. I am not thinking about that, but I am just thinking for better algorithm. This algorithm is for sure this will work, but this is not what the case. You got 5 or not, that is fine, but somewhere suppose if the first element itself is 0, let me check this. Now minimum is 0. 0 less than I is what? 0. 0 less than 0, false. 20 less than 0, false. 30 less than 0, false. 40 less than 0, false. 5 less than 0, false. What is minimum? 0. Iteration 2. Iteration 3. Give some 3 here. It's working, right? You have to just test it. That's all. 1 minute. Or somewhere in the middle, give some 6. Now, it starts like this. It takes 3. 3 is minimum first. Now 3 less than 3 is false. 20 less than 3 is false. 6 less than 3 is false. 40 less than 3 is false. 5 less than 3 is false. Which is the minimum now?
If the first value is minimum, then only it will work.
We are testing only for minimum, right?
First one.
Yes, that's it. You have to give some default from the array itself. Usually we set it 0 as the default from the 0th index. You got it right. That's how algorithm works. Any algorithm, you have to just take one value, random value. Otherwise, if you think that if you don't want 0, give some 3. Some value from array, set it as a default. That is, assume that minimum. So if you want to compare, you need some value from there, right? So take one value from that list and assume it as minimum, but it's not minimum. Now you do the comparison that with the rest of elements. Got it right? Is the algorithm working or not? Suppose I gave 2 here. Let me try this. I should get 2. Got it right? This is how we can implement. If it is while loop, then you can say that, what is that, x of I or y of I something. This is not while, you are directly getting element. Again, y x of I. I itself is holding element. This is perfect algorithm. You can take this. Okay, next one. Max, how do you do max? Just change, make small change to this code. Do you understand? See, algorithm, you get it with practice. See, I had written this code dynamically only in the classroom itself. I didn't prepared, I didn't execute it in my home and came here. Understood? But these are not that difficult to implement also. If I am saying that these are something else and giving a, what is that kind of this thing? No, these are simple algorithms only. Next, max, you tell me how to find max. Are you following the algorithm? Yes, sir, no. Sir, you have to take list, assume some element, if not zero, assume any element is minimum. Now you start doing comparison. Suppose if you are you, do you have any doubt, my dear friend? No, suppose take 40 now. Assume 40 is which element? No, the index of 40, 0, 1, 2, 3. Usually people take 0. Now minimum is 40. Now you take first I in X. So 3 less than 40, true or false? 3 less than 40, true or false? Do you have a doubt?
Sir, X of 3 is equal to 40. Minimum is equal to 40. We are directly assigning a value to minimum.
That's all correct only. So that's why I'm trying to say, what is there in I? 3. What is there in min? 40. 3 less than 40, how much? 3 less than 40, true or false? True. Then what I am trying to do? Minimum modified or not? It won't be always 40. Whenever this condition is true, this minimum get changed. And it is true that 3 is less than 40, then I have modified it. Is there any problem there? We are modifying. Don't think that it is always 40 here. Whenever any element which is less than, it is set to what? Minimum. Are you following this now? I think now you got it right. Earlier you were in little confusion. That's it. Understood now? Now run module and say what should I get now? What is the minimum here? 2 only. If I am getting that, the point is simple. Assume any one element from the list as what? List as what? Minimum or min. When you are doing for min, assume it min. Excuse me. When you are doing it for max, assume it as a, don't interchange it. Again, you get lost of this algorithm. Okay. So next one. So this is for min, not an issue. Next after that, what about max? What about max? Can you try max now? Maximum is opposite to this. But if you just blindly make changes to that and do it, it is not useful for us. What do you have to do? Understand and apply. I told you, sir, these sessions will be like this only. When you want to implement something practical, you should have patience. Those who don't have that, I told you. That is what the lacking thing in the industry. People don't have patience and they want lakhs of salaries. I don't know how it is possible. Max, I assume 40 as max, then I should make a small change to this. If I greater than max, see this small condition, how to apply filter if you understand it carefully. Everything is there, this small thing. Then what is that change? It's clearly there, I greater than max. Then change max to I. Are you following or not? Then run module. 1 minute.
You do not change this print.
Yes, I'll change it. Min is a function, that's why built-in function, that's why it is returning some address. Can you see there? Min is a built-in function. If you are thinking what is that, maybe better you change some other different names. Okay, instead of max, use max one, so that you are not using names of existing functions. There is nothing wrong if you are using, but not to get confused. as long as you know what you are doing, there is no problem. But if others don't know, then you have to change it. That is also one more important thing you have to learn as a part of implementation. It's not about just only you. Tomorrow you implement code and leave that company, the other one who enters into that foot, no, they has to plug their hand. If you are not making it readable and it is in right formats, what is the maximum element here, folks? 1 minute, my dear. Just a minute. You can help your friend. I am not against that. Okay, but only just listen when I am talking. That's all. So what is the maximum element? 40 only, right? By looking at that, you know, not eighth class, first class student answer this. That is what it is, a simple thing. We know everything, sir. Only thing is we should just need to apply it. How you implement it is the only point. You have question, you have answer, you know formula. When you look at it, you got everything. Got it? That's all, sir. This is idea about min max. Now you know how to find sum, how to find even number sprint, and one more last thing, finding count of numbers. How do you count, find count of elements inside this? Count of elements. Are you trying this, sir? Now I have done this. Some of you, you know, implemented. Some of you implemented half. Some of you, okay, learning for first time. But after doing this, if you don't execute on machines, all your efforts coming to this session and sitting here are, you know, going to be poured into the ashes. You have to go and execute on machines, sir. Then only it's useful. Not for online folks. Anyhow, machine is in front of you. So finally, what should I do right now? Count. How do you find count, guys? The easiest way is applying length. Kindergarten approach, nursery standard approach, right? Okay, let us be more. Okay, let us do it customized. Length gives you number of elements in the list or not? Any? Do you have any doubt? I will call junior LTR now. Of course, it's not possible for me. I'm just giving only a. Now take one variable, count one. Okay, count one equal to zero. Count is also built in function again. When functions are built in, make sure you take care of naming standards. Okay, don't use keywords as identifiers. Don't use usually that method names, built in method names as identifiers. But if you use method names or identifiers, nothing happens. But for keywords, there is an issue. Keep in mind, okay? How do you find count now? Every time loop iterates, just say what? Initially count is zero. Count equal to, if it is C, for us, it's very easy saying count plus plus. But in Python, there is no plus plus or minus, no unary operators, only assignment. See how to increment like this only. And increment by one, every time loop iterates. This gives us the count. So what is the count now? Just find out count one and just run this. Yeah, there is a small typo here. Change this to count one and then rerun the code and then run module and then you got five. I hope we have five elements in the array, right? Are you following, sir?
Yes.
I mean, making it you know, for you. Next. Mode. Before mode, I'll give one more small logic. We will break down so that even someone who is very new can understand it, what's happening in the background. Ready, right? So what you do is I'll give a small list of elements. Okay, 1 2 3 4 1 6 2, 3, 4, okay, 6, 2, 6, 1, 2, sorry, 5, 1, 2, anything is fine. You don't need to worry about it. So this is a small analysis. Now, what do you do is, I have elements like this, right? Yes, sir. See, if you want to apply machine learning, see, if you want to learn something, apply in data science. Many people think that data science is means you have to be good with Python and you are also good with R. Yes, algorithms first. Basics of stats is also important. Then only it's easy for you to implement in data science. Okay, so you have to apply this now. Stats in sense, you have a formula. You know the formula. It's there in the book. Even the it's there in the Google. As a developer, we can get it. But how do you convert it to an application? That is important. That's what I am trying to tell from the beginning. Now this is the requirement. Now you give me count of each individual element. What do you do? Give me how many times each individual element is recurring. You know, three record for how many times? By looking at it, I can answer. 20 record for one time, 6 record for two times, 40 record for one time, 2 record for four times, 1 record for three times, and 3 record for again, that's all. Which is most recurring element here? 2. That is mode. Understood? I'm making to implement this only. So if you want to apply mode, what do you have to do? Find the occurrences of every element first. How do you find occurrences? Got it right? This is again a new algorithm for you. Easiest way is not ID. No, there are functions to get it. Take help of functions. I don't want to, what is that? But without that, if you are doing, it's a good thing. I am confident I can apply without taking any built-in function help. But are you confident on that? Is important. I can do it. I didn't prepare and come. Again, I am telling you this. As a developer, you should be dynamic. When you have clear understanding of fundamentals, then you don't need to think too much. You will get the answer. Sit in front of machine. Keep doing it iteration wise. So it will take some time, but you get answer. So shall I do it with taking some built-in function help or without built-in function help? Okay, so you are giving me a challenge now. No problem. You are thinking this guy whether he implements or not. Okay, fine. I take the challenge. I'm ready. No, I'm just joking only. Don't take I don't offend people. Clear, right? So, okay, one of my students thrown challenge to me. But to be frank, this is not that difficult program. Then you might ask me a question. When do you tell something is difficult? Huh? I'll tell. There are times. So what you have to do is to get count. You take one element from simple common sense. Take one element. Compare with the rest of all elements. See that how many times it is coming. Get the count of that element. Following or not? Yes, sir. Simple. See, that is so simple, right? To understand also. That transform it to a code. See, even Kamal can understand. Kamal, did you understand or not? What should I do? No, I'm not saying transformation, all that. What you have to do? Tell me the algorithm. Take one element, compare with rest of elements. Something, do you have ever heard of bubble sort? Don't go for bubble sort. I am not asking bubble sort here. No, that also I will make you to implement. But for now, we are not doing what? Sorting. Some part of bubble sort you need to take. For comparing, you need two loops. How many loops, sir? One has to point to the starting element. One loop has to do the iteration. It has to move to the next element. Then you have to say every time this is matching with the rest of elements or not. Are you following or not? Sir, this kind of algorithms, n number of algorithms are there in your mind. There are a bunch of fruits in a bowl or a basket. Okay. There are different colors in the basket. Suppose you take fruit as apple. It might be green, it might be red, it might be yellow, it might be black, it might be blue. Suppose I gave a blue apple and I asked you, how many blue apples are there in a basket? Do you have an algorithm for that? Will you go and search in the basket or not? You take blue, your mind has blue in the mind. Now you compare that with only other blue elements in the basket. Yes or no? Basket is a collection, sir. Now what your mind will see, if it is green, it will, you will just keep it away. You will throw it. If it is yellow, you will throw it. If it is blue, then only you will pick it. Are you following or not? Are you, same thing you have to do here coding. When you are able to do that with basket, why can't you do this with this? Even rickshawwala can do that, right? Means you have common sense. Applying that in coding is important. So what do you do right now? How many loops do I need for I in range of
0 to?
I should iterate 0 to what? Because it starts with 0. 0 to, you have to take range function help now. For loop is directly applicable only on collections. Suppose if you want to iterate between x to y, starting with x ending with y, then you have to take help of which function? Range function. Suppose it starts with 0 comma, where should I end? Where should I end? At the end of this, not at 2. Take the index, don't look at the elements here. So what is the last index of 2? What is the last element of 2, sir? How do you get simple, right? Length minus 1, sir. If you say length, you get total number of elements. And if you say minus 1, that is the last index. Common sense, sir. Length means I don't know how many elements are there now. So I just simply say length of what? X. Should I give it like that or should I say minus 1? You want to get accurate result, you have to say what? Because length gives total number of elements, but as index starts with 0, you have to say minus 1. Length might give some 15, but actually there will be 14 elements. Length might give 15, 15 elements are there, but the indexing will be 0 to 14. I'm sorry. If it is 15, how can it be 14 elements? Foolishness. If it is 15, it starts with 0, ends with the 14. That you have to remember. Are you following, sir? So,
but in for loop, not included last
time. No, it's not like for loop is not something. For loop just only do iteration, sir. It doesn't have any knowledge. You have to take care of all this. Understood? So, next one. Am I done with this? This iterates from 0 to n minus 1. N might be 15 or 20 here. Okay. Means it will start from 0 to 14. I am assuming 15. It might be more or less. Nothing to worry. If you are still concerned, what you do? You can just quickly say L equal to ln of x so that you can print and see that. Then what is that? You can say the easiest way is this. Okay. Then what? Now again one more loop for what should I do now? For j in what should I take? This will iterate from 0 to, I am just only looking at the how to iterate from start point and end point. That is first loop. If this iterates for one time, outer loop iterates for one time, inner loop iterates until the condition is false there. Shall I repeat the statement? If you have nested loops, when outer loop iterates for one time, inner loop iterates until what? Condition is false. So what do you do right now? For j in? I have to iterate from starting with this. This gives me, what is that? Index of first element. Index of which element? First element. This gives me index of remaining all elements. Index of what? All elements. I don't need to compare first element with first element. Yes or no? But still, of course, take that also, because we are taking count, right? So what you have to do is, first of all, you have to take a variable count, initialize it to what? 0. That is important. Are you getting occurrences, right? Occurrences means count must be here. That how you do it? For j in range of, where should I start now? Where should I start? Again, here also I should start with the. You can start with I plus 1. That is for bubble sort. But this is for getting occurrences. So you can start from where? For matching, right? Matching should start with 0 only. Otherwise, you are missing one count. Then you got wrong answer. For bubble sort, I plus 1. But for occurrences, start with 0. Where should I end? Where should I end? Length of? Like otherwise, I can again L minus 1. Okay. If again, remember, if outer loop iterates for one time, inner loop iterates for how many times? Okay, here I missed something. What is that I missed? 1 minute. 1 minute. There is a small correction. We need to do this. And here also L minus 1. Perfect, right now? That's correct. Then do I correct point only? We know that range excludes upper limit, right? Last element is excluded from range function. So there is no external requirement to substitute minus 1. So you can directly pass 0 comma L. This is not 1. This is L. L for length. Now here comes the actual filter. If this one, this is actually the first element, then that has to be compared with all rest of elements. If where is this I? If I equal to equal to, sorry, if x of I, what is that x of I? If you say I and j, you are comparing just numbers, not the elements in the, not the elements in the list. If I x of I equal to equal to x of j, you can do it in different ways, sir. If any shortcut is there, you can try that also, sir. If I iterates, suppose I is 0, where now j is 0, so this j loop iterates for how many times, sir? 0 to n times. You can take n is also fine. 0 to n. Okay, so now when every time loop iterates, j loop iterates, it will compare the value of index I. Index I what? Value 3. Initially what we get here? X of I means x of 0. What is x of 0, sir? 3. Now you are comparing it continuously with the rest of all elements in the list, including itself. You are saying if x of I equal to j, j starts with 0, I starts with 0. This will be same for how many times, sir? You compare this, this is for iterating through the collection. This will be getting your first value and keeping it there. Now you are comparing that first value with remaining all the elements. Got it right? So what do you do right now? You have to say count a count 1 equal to count 1 plus 1. Are you following now? Actually, you have to preserve this to some map kind of data structure. What kind of data structure? As you are not aware of map, for now I am just printing it directly. Later on I will show you how to get that also, how to preserve your key and values. Okay, now finally, after getting complete iteration inside, I am printing this where count one. So here I comma, okay, occurs what? Otherwise simply say I comma count one. Got it right? This is value, how many times it is recurring. Following, and finally what you do, save this program, there, go there, run module. 0 is coming for how many times, sir? 1 minute. I is what? Yes, correct. Sorry. It should be what? X of So 3 coming for how many times, sir? 3 times. But there is a small correction here to this code. What is that? Once after you found counter at the end, again reset it to how much, sir? Zero. If you don't do that, again we are gone. This is also very important. Very important step you have to follow. Resetting values is also important. You have finished eating, drinking tea. Should we clean it and keep it ready or not? Same thing. That is called resetting. Okay. Go to run and then apply. I'll close it and come back. There are few validations we have to do again. I'll give again. 3 is coming for how many times, sir? Leave about 20. 20 how many times, sir? 1. 6 how many times, sir? You can see here. Anywhere you can have another output also. 6 with the whichever is for 6, it is showing max. That is the max one. Okay. And then 40 how many times, sir? 1 time. 2 how many times, sir? 4 times. 1 how many times, sir? 3 times. 2 how many times, sir? 4 times. 2 is iterating. Of course, it is showing actual count only. Why it is again coming, again and again it is coming? Because these elements, whenever it moves further, initially it will do for count of 3, count of 20, count of 6, count of 40, count of 2, count of 1. Now, till this, there is no repetition. Again, you are starting count of 2. Then you ask me a question. I don't want this many repetitions, sir. I did perfect count. So 3, how many times? 3 times. 20, how many times? 1 time. 6, how many times, sir? 2 times. 40, how many times? 1 time. 2, how many times, sir? 4 times. Like that, 3 times. So for that, we'll do it in the next session. This is how you have to keep building your coding, sir. Are you following? Somewhere you have a little doubt here at this point, if I am not wrong, if at all, if you have a doubt, how this is working. But anyhow, we'll do it tomorrow because you have got enough today. But I told you in the beginning itself, more than me, you have to be more prepared for all this kind of stuff. Understood now? Is the algorithm clear or not? What did I do here? You can just analyze this. This iterates for how many times, sir? First of all, how many elements are there? 17 elements are there. Length is 17. It iterates for how many times this range? Range iterates for 17 times only. It iterates for how many times, sir? All the 17 elements. First you get what? 0. 0 is not value, index. These two are iterating only through indexes. What?
Index.
Not through values. Okay, so initially 0 comes to I and then 0 comes to, and now you go to the j loop. Just observe it once. Now it goes to j loop. What is j now? Now j loop iterates for how many times? Tell me.
17
times. If I is 0, then j iterates for 17. If I is 1, j iterates for 17. If I is 2, j iterates for 17 times. If I is 3, j iterates for, are you following this or not? Outer loop iterates for 1 time, inner loop iterates for n times. Means until the condition is false, instead of n times, until the condition of inner loop is false. Are you following this? Now you see, first you have 0. Now you are taking element from 0th index. That is x of I. When you say I, this is just index. When I say x of I, that is the from the, from where? From the array. Got it right? So now x of I equal to x of j. What is that? X of j. Now x of j means it iterates from first, it will compare with first one. It will compare with second one. Compare with third. Every time it is matching, you are incrementing count. Following this or not? Then finally print that. Still we can optimize this. What we can do? If you ask me exact the number and count beside, I can give that also. Do you have a doubt? Anybody has doubt there? Got it right? So that is the point. So tomorrow what you do is this is like to get mode concept. Which concept?
Mode.
This gives you mode, nothing but. There are other programs again, removing duplicates. One more important thing. Sometimes you have a data set, from that we should remove duplicates and filter it. How to copy? elements from one to another. And also we see functions of list before moving further. Got it right? I think we have almost done for up to 12. Today we have exceeded our time. Any questions now? So that's all, folks. So this anyhow, we need to filter it. We need to optimize it further. This might give correct output, but this output is not in a right standard. So that's it. Thank you, guys.
Videos on the YouTube channel, you said
LearnWell Space Tech. See, if you want any previous videos, if you want to go through any previous videos, use this channel LearnWell Space Tech. You can type in Google and you can get it. Sorry, you can type in chat, check in, check in YouTube. Okay, so there you have all the previous sessions. Because when you are coming to these sessions, you have to at least have some idea and come. Because I am not just taking conceptual training here. It's more an implementation based only. So those who are in, having some idea at least on some fundamentals, for them, it's fine. Those who come, missing all the sessions will be a little difficult. Okay. Because I am looking only something which